Our sun, this is lighting up our days since 4.5 billion of years. It is a star. However, it doesn't look anything like the twinkling stars in the night sky. The first person to suggest the sun is a star was Anaxagoras, back in 450 BC. However, his ideas went against the common faith and belief of that time, so he was imprisoned. Since then, it took more than 2000 years to prove that sun is a star. Finally, in 1838, Frederick Bessel calculated the distance of different stars in the night sky, and he showed that the star would look equally bright if they are as close as sun. This solved the puzzle. It is often said that sun is a medium-sized star, but that's quite misleading. It's true that in the size range of star, sun comes somewhere in the middle. But vast majority of stars are dim red dwarf stars, much fainter than sun. By size and number, sun ranks among the top 10% stars of our galaxy. So it's clearly a dominant object, brighter, more massive, and more influential than most of the stars of our galaxy. Our sun is essentially a huge ball of hydrogen gas, around 1.4 million km in diameter. We can fit over a million of hours inside it. It is around 300,000 times more massive than Earth. This huge mass creates an extremely strong gravitational field at its core. It squeezes the hydrogen atoms so close that they fuse together to form helium and lots of energy. Our sun converts 700 million tons of hydrogen into 695 million tons of helium each second every day. At least 5 million tons of matter gets converted into energy. At this rate, we can convert the entire matter of Mount Everest into energy just in a couple of hours. Photons, those are produced in sun's core, have to travel a long distance just to come outside. Sun's core is surrounded by a region called radiative zone. The plasma here is not as dense as sun's core to make fusion happen, but it's still very dense and photons struggle to move through it. Photons bounce in the plasma here and move in a zigzag path called random walk. In this region, no energy is being generated, but energy is getting transmitted via radiation, hence the name radiative zone. Photons take 200 to 300 thousands of years just to cross this region. Once photons crosses the radiative zone, it comes to a convection zone. The plasma here is less thicker and hence convection is possible. The columns of hot plasma rise to the sun's surface and the energy gets released. The plasma cools down and sinks back into the interior. We can see these columns of hot plasma on sun's surface as granular patterns. Sun's atmosphere is composed of different layers. The lowermost layer is known as photosphere. This is the only visible part on sun's atmosphere. And when we see sun through our naked eyes, we actually see this layer. The next layer is known as chromosphere, and the outermost layer is corona. These layers are not visible to our naked eyes because they mostly emit in ultraviolet or X-rays and some visible emission from corona. The optical emission of corona is fainter in compared to photosphere. That's why you cannot see corona in front of photospheric bright light. These two layers are visible only during solar eclipse or using some special equipment. Chromosphere is visible as bright flash during the beginning and end of some total solar eclipse. The temperature of photosphere is around 6000 Kelvin. Then it increases gradually and reaches around 20,000 Kelvin in chromosphere. Then it increases rapidly and reaches around 100,000 Kelvin in a transition region between chromosphere and corona. The average temperature of corona is 1 to 2 million of Kelvin. As we are going away from the heat source, the temperature should fall. So one obvious question one can ask, how the outer layer of sun, the corona, is heated up to millions of Kelvin in compared to photosphere, where the temperature is just 6,000 Kelvin. So this is one of the biggest puzzles still not solved, and scientists are working on it. The surface of sun is a complete mess, and the key to that mess is magnetism. Sun's interior is in constant motion. The convecting plasma coupled with sun's rotation creates rivers of plasmas. Each of them carries their own magnetic fields. This creates zillions of magnetic loops around sun and not a single magnetic axis like Earth. When plasma comes to a surface, it cools down. However, if magnetic fields are present, then it will prevent the plasma from coming up. So the plasma cools further down, causing this region to dim. From Earth, we see this as sunspots. Plasma can also flow through these magnetic fields. This creates huge fiery arc-like structures known as filaments, spreading across hundreds of kilometers on Sun. The magnetic fields carry huge amount of energy in them. Sometimes these magnetic fields can get short-circuited and releases huge amount of energy and material from Sun. These are known as solar flares. Solar flares are one of the most spectacular phenomena occurring in Sun's atmosphere due to sudden release of huge amount of energy. Big flares are often observed to be accompanied with coronal mass ejections. It is believed that the energy stored in the magnetic fields suddenly releases and the plasma gets heated up to millions of Kelvin in the process. Huge amount of energy and material expelled from Sun's atmosphere. Solar flares and coronal mass ejections are capable of accelerating huge amount of energetic particles from solar corona to interplanetary medium. These are actually responsible for polar light caps, aurora borealis. This can also disrupt the communication system and cause serious threats to the space stations and satellites. That's why scientists study all these activities carefully. Things going on around the space, and our goal is to present those to you. If you miss a chance to subscribe to this channel, then you will miss a golden opportunity to learn about many interesting things. Thank you.